something strange has been happening in the remote area of a forest near a king's castle. Every hunter that goes near this area disappears, never to be seen again. Others are sent to search for them, and they go missing as well. People begin to believe this area is cursed and decide simply never to go there. A hunter shows up one day and asks the king if there is any dangerous work that needs to be done. The king immediately tells him about the forest and warns him of the strange disappearances. This turns out to be exactly the type of adventure the hunter was seeking, so he sets out. The young hunter wanders with his dog into the forest until they pass a pond. Suddenly, a hand reaches up from the water, grabs the dog, and pulls it underneath. As much as he loved the dog, the young man doesn't become hysterical. He simply recognizes that this is the place. He goes back to the castle and rounds up three men, and together they return to bucket the water out of the pond. It is slow and monotonous work, but they get to the bottom and discover a large man covered in hair from head to toe. His hair is reddish like rusty iron, so they give him the name Iron John. They take him back to the castle where he is immediately imprisoned by the king, who then gives the key into the care of the queen. When a man looks into his psyche, deep underneath the water, in a place no one has visited for a very long time, he finds this ancient hairy man lying there. Man, as we see him today, is a late and uncommon phenomenon, a blip on the radar of human history. Only recently has there been a rapid evolution where all of our animal instincts have become useless, and in order to survive, we must now rely on our conscious mind rather than our unconscious impulses. If we do actually discover this wild man exists within us, what is our first impulse? To lock him up and pretend he isn't there. Parents, teachers, ministers, and principals have been telling us our entire life that we should have nothing to do with him, that we should be frightened of him. When he comes out in school, we medicate him away. One day, the king's 8-year-old son is playing in the courtyard with a golden ball he loves. He loses the ball and it rolls into Iron John's cage. If he wants it back, he must approach the wild man and ask him for it. The boy is 8, and it is around this age that all of us, boy or girl, loses something of incredible value. This is the same golden ball in The Princess and the Frog that is lost to the bottom of the pond. It is also the golden ball that Harry Potter is so desperately trying to catch. It represents the most important thing in our lives. It reminds us of that unity of personality we had as children, a kind of radiance or wholeness we possessed before the more difficult aspects of life began to set in. If we still have the ball in kindergarten, we lose it in grade school. If we still have it in grade school, we lose it in high school. And once the ball is gone, we spend the rest of our lives trying to get it back. Obviously, this wouldn't be much of a story if Iron John simply gave the ball back to him. Instead, our psyche is a deal maker and we must be willing to bargain with it. So Iron John offers the boy a deal. He will give the ball back if the boy agrees to open the cage. The boy gets frightened and runs off, but he returns the next day. In reality, this day that has passed might be 10 years. On the second day, the boy can now be 25. He asks, "Can I have my ball back?" The wild man says yes, if you let me out of my cage. The boy hears him, but by now he has 2 Toyotas, a mortgage, and possibly a wife and kids. How can he possibly let the wild man out now? He leaves again without saying a word and returns the next day. On this third day, perhaps another 10 years have passed. The boy is now 35. Look into the eyes of a 35-year-old man and what do you see? Men that are overworked, alienated, and completely beaten down by life. Again, he asks him, "Can I have my ball back?" The wild man says yes, if you let me out of my cage. This time the boy responds, "Even if I wanted to let you out, I don't know where the key is." The wild man tells him the key is under his mother's pillow. It is here the story takes a very Freudian turn. In case you're not familiar with Freud, in one of his more famous ideas, the Oedipus complex, he describes what he thought of as a universal infantile wish we all have to kill our fathers and sleep with our mothers, and vice versa for father-daughter relationships, something we are still vehemently suppressing to this very day. And now you know why literally everyone in the world hates Freud. While many believe he is mistaken in his attempt to reduce all general problems of humanity down to this kind of repressed sexuality, he was able to diagnose a very real problem. It is the stereotype of the father with a shotgun at his daughter's wedding, or the 30-year-old man living in his mother's basement. It is the overbearing and overprotective tendency all parents, and especially mothers, feel for their children. But it is wrong, except in extreme cases, to place the blame on the mother, as many in the Freudian school are prone to do. For where would we all be without the fierce protection we receive from our mothers? In another time, it was the tribe who would decide when to take the boy away from his mother and guide his transition into adulthood. These initiation rites would be incredibly challenging. The boy would be left out in the wilderness, have his body covered in fire ants, or left somewhere clinging halfway between life and death. While you might say there is no place for this in a civilized society, the complete absence of initiation, along with the epidemic of the 30-year-old man-child we see today, might have some correlation. The message is clear. At some point, there must be a clean break from the family and a proper transition into adulthood. But our most common form of initiation today is the frat. It is boys initiating boys. There are few men, and even fewer, who are actively guiding the initiation of the next generation. So for many, the key remains hidden. No matter what it takes, he must get the key back, and he must realize that nobody is going to come along and do it for him. The key is being held underneath the pillow, perhaps in our parents' dreams and expectations for us. They wanted to raise a doctor or a lawyer, and they definitely did not want to raise a wild man. The boy agrees to take the key and free Iron John, but as he is opening the cage, he cuts his finger on the rusty lock. Breaking away from the parents, defying their wishes, and freeing the wild man, these things will always cause a wound. These wounds come in various forms. It can be dealt in a single blow, or it can be a steady poison drip of shame, constantly reminding you how you are not living up to their standards. In many primitive societies, outward scarring is given as a reminder of internal scars. The important distinction is that the scarring is not coming from a place of cruelty, but rather from a place of profound meaning. There is a reason children wear scars and broken bones as badges of honor. They are looked at with awe and respect. Adolescence is a time of extreme risk, and suffering wounds is essential to our growth. Once we are wounded, we have a few options. We can take the road of grandiosity. We try to rise above it all, but like Peter Pan or Icarus, we fly too high. We turn into megalomaniacs or remain naive children. We can take the road of numbness and turn into addicts. If modern man were a bullfighter, he would simply let the bull trample over his body and then wallow in self-pity and talk about how unavoidable it was, medicating himself with alcohol, drugs, porn, or worst of all, memes. Or we can choose not to forget our wounds, but also not to wallow in self-pity. Instead, we can use them to uncover the real depths of our potential. Where our wound is, that is where our genius will be found. Now that Iron John is set free, the boy has a few options. He can stay and take all the blame for releasing him. He can sulk in pity over his wounded finger, or he can run away with him. Of course, we know what the boy will do, just as we know what we all must do. So once the boy has run away and followed Iron John into the wilderness, what happens next? Well, that is a story for another day.
Thank you so much for watching, and if you enjoyed the video, please subscribe for more, and of course, leave a comment because I love to hear from you guys. Thank you.